Hello friends, my greetings to everyone. I am Seema and I head Business Analysis Practices at Eisenbridge. I welcome you all on this segment of Discuss Agile webinar series. Discuss Agile is one of the most popular Agile communities in India and hosting regular events both online and offline. It's focused to connect Agile practitioners to share their experiences and knowledge to bring their skills to the next level. And Discuss Agile Group is supported by Eisenbridge, and we sponsor at least 4 big conferences in different cities of India in a year. And basic objective to promote learning and networking. Topic of today's session is action-based Scrum, how effective Scrum mastering can rescue troubled team. This topic will be presented by our guest speaker, Mr. Krishnamurty, and he's quite experienced Agile coach, and he has been spoke in many national and international Agile conferences, and training and coaching has been his passion in the area of his expertise. So friends, before commencing the topic with Mr. Krishnamurty, I request you to post your questions in your question box, and Mr. Krishnamurty will reply at the end of the session.
Thank you, Seema. Good evening, friends. I thank your time come to this webinar. I wanted to thank Discuss Agile platform for inviting me to speak here. Topic of today is action-based Scrum. How effective Scrum mastering can rescue troubled teams. At the end of this session, you'll be able to learn prescriptive Scrum versus action-based Scrum. So you'll understand what is prescriptive Scrum and what is action-based Scrum. And you also understand that Scrum Master role is quite influential in leading positive change. We also will go through a case in point where how effective Scrum mastering can rescue troubled teams and can help teams to succeed. So that is the agenda of today's session, my dear friends. Now, with this in place, I just wanted to start with a poll. Seema, can you start the first poll?
Yes, I'm launching the first poll. Yes, it is available to the audience.
Friends, please provide your option there.
Okay, friends, I'm closing the poll. So 39% are saying they are agree, 37% are saying they are partially agree, and 20% are saying that they are not agreed, and 5% cannot rate.
Excellent. Thank you, Seema. That sets the perfect platform for our webinar. If you add up agree and partial agree, close to 70% our participants are saying in their own organizations, Scrum mastering role is mostly restricted to facilitation of Scrum events. So Scrum master is looked at as custodian of Agile practices. So if Agile practice is not implemented properly, that means if stand-up is not happening properly, or if people are not conducting sprint planning part one, part two, means whether those sessions are happening or not, that's the only focus Scrum Master is actually focusing upon. So with 70% of the people agreeing to this particular thing, that means we really need to think about whether what is the role of a Scrum Master, how he can help better the context. Can he do? Is his role most influential? So that's what is the topic of today's session. So first I wanted to introduce the concept called prescriptive Scrum. What is prescriptive Scrum? Prescriptive Scrum is, you know what, we have a sprint planning session. So we all need to sit here for about 2 hours, and we have to groom stories, and we have to come up with the targeted stories for the sprint. Then we go for sprint planning part two. Okay. At the end of the thing, at the end of the session, are we coming up with, sprint backlog or not? And then next daily Scrum meeting every day. Then you know what? The daily Scrum meeting is happening. Okay, happening. So if not, you have to make it happen. Similarly, sprint review. Is review happening? Yes. Is retrospective happening? Yes. So I see that while Scrum is prescribing these events, but on field, it is happening as if a checklist-wise, all these things are happening or not. That's what we're actually seeing. So, for example, sprint planning part one, whether value is generated or not. Part two, whether value is understood, realized or not. Next, the daily stand-up meeting. Are people discussing their dependencies? Are people updating each other on the 3 points? You know, what did I do yesterday? What am I going to do today? And what I have dependency on others. So are we discussing? Do we realize the value or not? See, today if you see, on ground, I see most of the situations wherein Scrum is implemented as if it is prescriptive, means we have to make it happen. I came across situations wherein somebody comes and says, look, Krishnamurti, why do I require retrospective when retrospective is not adding value? So just because we have to have some retrospective meeting, we're actually performing that event, and we are feeling that time is getting wasted. So what I'm telling my dear friend, prescriptive Scrum is, it is what it is. That means we are implementing these Scrum events just because they are told. That's how is this prescriptive Scrum is happening. If you introspect on what is happening on the field, is most of scenarios. You know what? Because we all are tagging that agile flavor on ourselves, we are actually sprint planning and daily stand-up meeting, sprint review, sprint retrospective. So all these things are happening just because they have to happen. But action Scrum is the next part I am actually asking. My dear friends, today the emerging topic that is actually coming is action Scrum. That means all of us, everybody, means the product owner, the development team and the Scrum Master, they have to put all their best effort to make sure that we actually align to the customer value addition, sprint after sprint, iteration after iteration. So how can we realize action-based Scrum? Action-based Scrum is actually focusing on value-based output. At the same time, everybody is doing their best possible job. So in action-based Scrum, we'll be talking about, is sprint planning is adding value to me? Okay, why should I do 2 hours? Why can't I complete it in half an hour? Because those stories I have just groomed in the last product backlog refinement session. Similarly, by the time we come to the stand-up meeting, probably people can actually update their visual board, their task board, and actually they only focus on discussing their dependencies and their just crucial updates. In prescriptive Scrum, just because it has to happen, it is happening. In action-based Scrum, all the people, all the parties, the development team, the product owner, and the Scrum Master, everybody puts their effort so that it becomes a wheel. Every time the wheel rotates, you actually achieve some height. So action-based Scrum, my dear friends, it means you're actually generating value. The retrospectives are adding value. People are involved, people basically participate, they contribute to retrospectives, and they come up with actions, and they'll actually prioritize those actions, and they'll adapt to those prioritized actions in the next sprint. Similarly, sprint planning happens. So during sprint planning, most of the items that you're actually taking to sprint backlog, you must have actually discussed in the last product backlog refinement session or before that. But only last minute changes to the sprint stories, whatever stories that the product owner is asking you to take into the product backlog, those things when you're discussing, you're optimizing the time, you're actually taking team's input, you're involving team. So everything is basically value-based. Everybody can actually question, why I'm not generating value? Why should I do that? Thereby, the action-based Scrum is more of value generation day after day, iteration after iteration. So my dear friend, if I have to summarize action-based Scrum, means the iteration of iteration, every event, every hour, every task, every moment, the team understands the value. They basically go ahead and contribute value, they question each other, and they basically excel each other. That's what is action-based Scrum. Today, the emerging topic is we want Scrum to be action-based, value-based, not just prescriptive-based. Maybe it can start as a prescriptive-based just to make sure people gets into proper orbit, but after that, it has to get onto action-based. So my dear friend, I wanted to start another poll here. Can you please provide your answer? In your own organizations, do you think that Scrum methodology is implemented in prescriptive way? So when I say prescriptive way, I mean just because it has to happen, it is happening. All the people around you, are they finding the value because of it? Can you just provide your answer? Seema, can you please start the poll?
Okay, friends, I'm closing the poll. I'm providing the results. 38% people are saying that they are agree. 49% people are saying that they are partially agree. 6% do not agree. And 8% cannot rate.
Good. So, my dear friends, it actually sets another logical milestone to our webinar. Okay. So friends, now with this in case, so if you compare, if you add up agree and partially agree, close to 80% are saying the Scrum methodology is implemented in prescriptive way. So we need to change. We need to change the way the Scrum is getting implemented. Now, unless we do that, suddenly we see that, you know, Agile is not actually helping us. You'll see ground coming back and saying, look, we want to be in Agile, but you know, we are not seeing any value. The reason is, we are actually implementing Scrum methodologies in prescriptive way. So let us take one case, okay, where we actually see how, in this case, teams could able to turn the tough situation towards a positive point. A Scrum Master, especially, how he could help different steps. On the ground, we see a scenarios wherein Scrum Master says, as long as the sprint, the Scrum events are happening, I'm fine. So that kind of behavior is getting evolved on the ground. That's what I'm also observing. So that's what the teams are also feeling. Even the latest survey by Scrum Alliance also says the same thing. So that's why, my dear friends, in this particular case study, we will see how Scrum Master role is influential, powerful, and how he can make difference. So the context that I want to take here is there's a Scrum team who is actually continuously missing on sprint goals. So they sat together and said, why we are missing continuously? Then they conducted the fishbone diagram to understand the root causes. They came up with ineffective Scrum events, means Scrum events are actually not happening properly. The planning is not happening properly. Development-wise, the synchronization is not happening properly. Testing-wise, they are finding issues. Collaboration-wise, they are actually finding issues. So also, the Scrum events are being happening in prescriptive way. So my dear friends, if you see, all the problems we can actually see on the ground are there in this particular context. Let's see how a Scrum Master could able to influence the situation and can help teams towards positive change. First, the Scrum Master, Scrum events, how he can support the team. See here, human-based touch is very, very important. The Scrum Master has to really feel as servant leader. When I say servant leader, he needs to serve the team in order to drive them towards the goals. First point the Scrum Master can do is working agreements adhered. So first, Scrum Master can go back to the team and say, what are the working agreements? Okay, is there a way to revise it? Can it be current? Can it be relevant? So there's always a positive change that comes out of it. For example, team members are not coming on time, or team members uses their laptop during the Scrum events, or team members takes the phone call and talks, or some people try to topple others, some people try to dominate others. So those are the things that actually you see, those are small things that actually can create some kind of disturbance, or it can put our Scrum events towards wrong side. So as a Scrum Master, looking at working agreements, looking at definition of done, looking at definition of ready, looking at the information radiators, he can always think about, can we modify this? What are the problems we are facing? This is kind of a preparation. Okay, so that is the first area where Scrum Master can help. You can ask me, are we not doing on the ground? Well, you all can actually retrospect. Whatever we are doing is, we are basically setting the working agreements during the sprint zero, and mostly probably for 6 months or 8 months, we don't touch that. I mean, we don't try to revisit our working agreements. The ideal frequency of revisiting the working agreements, the definition of done, the definition of ready, is you can do periodically, but the periodicity should not be more than a month or 2 months. Every 2 months minimum, you have to make sure that, you know, you revisit it. So in this case, the Scrum Master went to the teams and said, look, my dear friends, what are the problems we are facing? Yeah, people are not coming on time. Or, you know, people are actually looking at the laptops. So such kind of issues, he took it up. And he basically said, why not we revisit working agreements? Why not we revisit definition of done? Why not we revisit definition of ready? And he made sure that with the team support, he actually gathered the revised working agreements, definition of done, definition of ready, and made sure that those things are posted on team rooms. The second point is Scrum Master is preparing for each event. For example, we know teams are going through troubled situation. So if you talk about sprint retrospective, or let's talk about sprint planning, okay, what is the expected outcome? Okay, this is the outcome. What kind of challenges our team can go through? Okay, there will be some dominators are there, or certain times product owner may not come to the sprint planning with stories clearly written. Or, you know, people may not take certain, you know, people's decision or discussions may go offline. So Scrum Master have to foresee each event and say, okay, this is the expected outcome. These kind of challenges can come. So these are the possible, you know, preparatory steps we can do as a team. So typically in this case, Scrum Master is foreseeing each event and then he's accordingly preparing the team. Certain times he do on in front of the team, formally he do the coaching. Certain times he goes to individually and he sets the situation properly. So what I'm trying to say is he's actually taking every event very seriously, and it's just not that he starts actioning during the event, but before the event itself he's actually doing preparation. The third thing is human test Scrum Master notifies team about Scrum events in advance. For example, if you see on the ground, I see that, you know, certain Scrum Masters, they call for sprint planning meeting probably one day before, or certain times on the same day, or certain times they're on fly. So it's very important that because these are all time box events, it's important to notify team at least 1 to 2 weeks before. I've seen good Scrum Masters who are actually, you know, scheduling a recurring meeting series about sprint planning, sprint retrospectives, product backlog refinement sessions, and daily stand-up meetings. So in your scenarios, if things are happening properly, that's fine. But in this scenario, it's not. Okay? If sprint, they actually take this situation. So the Scrum Master, in this case, he's actually made sure that recurring meeting invite is sent to all people, and people are aware of these Scrum events in advance. And then, what is available information for these sprints, for the events, and what are the expected deliverables? For example, if you are starting a sprint planning session, we are saying, Scrum Master says, look, my dear friends, at the end of part one, we expect the product owner to tell us what kind of stories are prioritized for the sprint, and we expect the product owner to clarify our team's questions. We expect the team to get their questions clarified from the product owner so that they can take those prioritized stories for sprint planning part two, because it is part two where they actually split the stories into tasks, assign hours, and then they will see their capacity and then come back saying that, you know, these stories I can take, these stories I cannot take. So basically what Scrum Master is doing is at the end of each, at the start of each event, he's setting the tone. For example, if I take retrospective, in the retrospective he's saying, look, this is what is the probable agenda. Maybe team can actually modify this, but once we agree on this agenda, let's focus on it. At the end of this particular retrospective, we want all the previous action items to be walked through, and also we also want to make sure that we generate more action items out of this retrospective. We prioritize the action items and we take actions we adopt in the next sprint. So my dear friends, what is happening is a humane touch Scrum Master is taking each sprint event, each Scrum event very, very seriously. He's notifying team in advance. He's setting the expectations properly and he's moving and he's actually guiding the teams in that way. You can ask me, are we not doing? Yeah, please look at the on the ground. I see some of the Scrum Masters, they basically come to the event and they start actioning. So that's where they're actually losing the opportunity of making good preparation towards the Scrum events. So that's why, my dear friends, so in this case, the Scrum Master is actually, actioning. He's doing a good preparation. And then the final thing is he's dealing Scrum events creatively. First, that event should be time-boxed. Then, innovative facilitation techniques. For example, we come across a lot of challenges, like, you know, people may not participate in a retrospective, or people may not participate in your product backlog refinement session, or certain people may be dominating in planning sessions or certain sessions, or during the daily stand-up meeting, it's getting, you know, beyond 15 minutes. So, or people in during stand-up meeting, people may actually spend time in terms of, you know, these hours I work, these hours I'm going to work, like kind of a transactional update. So, a lot of challenges Scrum Master can come through. So, in this case, what is he doing is he's identifying what we know, what are the team strengths, what are the team weaknesses, where we have to go. So he knows where we are. He's actually drawing a line where we have to go. And he's drawing the lines creatively from event to event. For example, whatever technique, facilitation, retrospective technique he uses to sprint may change for the next time. So the team gets a feel of change. They don't feel retrospectives are monotonous. Similarly, the sprint planning sessions, he's probably making sure that 80% of the stories targeted for this current sprint planning session, they're actually touched upon in the earlier product backlog refinement session. Only 15 to 20% of the new stories or new additions are being taken up. So towards this, I have seen some Scrum Masters who basically forms a core team of 2-3 members and product owner, and they basically skim through the stories so that they bring some reasonable clarity, and then they bring those stories for the sprint planning session. So that, you know, quickly we can understand the stories, clarifications can be provided, and with less time we can get more productivity. So in this situation, as far as Scrum events are concerned, the Scrum Master is making sure good preparation, notifying people well in advance, understanding the challenges, understanding where to know, identifying team strengths, and then coming up with creative ideas and to make sure that, you know, people find these Scrum events more, you know, joyful, playful, at the same time creative. And also he's expecting the outcome, he's setting the expectations, saying that probably these are the outcomes we may want to achieve, so that he's also giving an opportunity for the team to modify the agenda at the beginning of the event itself, so that he gets the people buy-in and then he's moving on. So this is where how, as far as Scrum events are concerned, a Scrum Master can make difference. Now I am moving to the next theme called planning. Okay, how in planning session Scrum Master can do? First, let me tell you, in normal scenario on the field, what is happening is we all, when a development team comes, product owner comes, and the Scrum Master comes. So the moment everybody is together, the Scrum Master is taking back seat. Okay, they will discuss. That's how he is actually thinking. But in this particular scenario, how Scrum Master is helping? He helps product owner in terms of planning agile planning events. You all know the planning onion, right? So right from strategic planning, portfolio planning, product planning, release planning, sprint planning, daily planning, all those planning events, you know what? He's actually helping the team. He's helping product owner to get them organized properly. He's a servant leader. He doesn't care what is my responsibility, what is your responsibility. He basically, wherever his support is required, he just goes and supports. He sees his success in terms of the positive outcome he creates. Similarly, he helps product owner in coming up with effective user stories. When I say effective user stories, that means first the user stories should be written properly as per the suggested template. At the same time, the stories should follow the invest principle. That means independent, negotiable, verifiable, testable, sizable, and estimable. So the it should be written in that way. The product, the Scrum Master can help product owner. He can help the team to make sure that stories are split properly. He may look at the acceptance criteria. He may say, look, if this is what we have to achieve, why not we split it? Similarly, he can basically suggest or educate the product owner or the team in terms of different prioritization techniques. He can also ask teams, why not you label this story as upstream for this particular downstream story, so that everybody in the system knows that unless the upstream story is completed, downstream story is not done. So typically, he helps the product owner, he helps the development team in doing this. So the critical picture or the critical outcome that I want to bring through this particular thing is, it is just not facilitating the events and writing the minutes of the meeting. It's about understanding the backbone value of this each event and making sure the value is reached out to the target participants. So my dear friends, he can actually help the product owner on this perspective. Similarly, coming to the teams, helping teams, he can basically make sure that, you know, teams are taking only definition-ready stories itself. Friends, it is true that, you know, teams on the ground, they, while taking stories to their sprint backlog during sprint planning part one session, some of the stories, even though they know that they are not very clear and they don't, the stories are not adhering to the definition of ready, still teams are accepting. Scrum Master courageously helps the team to reject those stories and tell the product, look, these stories are not compliant to the definition of ready set. So we have to make sure that the stories are written properly, then only they can qualify for our sprint planning session. So he can basically courageously, he can help team to make sure that stories are only clearer stories, stories that are meeting the definition of ready concept is taken. Similarly, he can help teams leverage spikes and research options. For example, certain scenarios we have seen, even though teams are not very clear about, you know, how to achieve, or they're not very clear about the business objectives of the story, especially first time when they're actually, discovering new stories, they're embarking on new stories, new features, Scrum Master can say, why not you take a spike story? Or why not you take up a research story? So let all of us have clarity about the business objectives. So Scrum Master can actually encourage teams to take spike stories or research stories whenever possible or wherever applicable, so that, you know, everybody has same clarity. Friends, on ground what I've seen is teams actually pick up stories even though they are not clear about business objectives, especially when they're actually taking new features. And during the sprint, they actually connect another design solution and they identify, look, this story takes more time than anticipated. We come across more tasks, so this story cannot be taken up. So such kind of scenarios we see on the ground. Instead of having a second or third design discussion during the sprint, means fifth day or sixth day of the sprint, it's better to take a spike and you know, wet your hands. Make sure that, you know, you have clarity about what are you doing, and then go for a research story, and then make sure that, you know, your possible options, and you are actually identifying the best possible option. Similarly, for the part one and part two sprint, the Scrum Master can help saying that, you know, everybody is okay with this, sprint backlog. Are you fine? So this way, even though some people are trying to dominate, if some others are not actually supporting this idea, Scrum Master say, look, out of six people we have in front of us, only five people are agreeing. One person is not agreeing. One person is not confident that, you know, our team can meet the goal. So what can be the reason? He can actually use that particular option to create further discussion, making sure at the end of the day, all risks, all uncertainties are to the best of the team capacity are discussed, and then only sprint backlog is identified. Similarly, in planning part two, we have seen teams, basically, they come up with activity detailing, but certain times they don't detail task activities properly for each of the stories. They don't sequence stories properly. I have seen many scenarios wherein they just add up the hours required for each activity, and then they compare it with team capacity. That's not the way, because, for example, testing will not start unless development completes. So just a simple addition of hours activity-wise that doesn't, and comparing with the available capacity is not going to help us. So that's why he helps team in detailing activities for each story, in sequencing them. Similarly, he asks the right questions to enable reuse and optimal estimates. So Scrum Master, his role is to question. His role is to make people think so that people can actually leverage the reuse and they come up with optimal estimates. And also, wherever certain risks or uncertainties are there, then they accommodate some buffers in their estimates. That's how the team can confidently complete whatever stories they committed and the sprint goal can be met. So, my dear friends, if you think planning session, it's just not sending minutes and or you know inviting people, putting them into a room, and then publishing minutes of the meeting. Lot of things happens. He works with the product owner, he works with the team, he helps sprint planning part one, he helps planning part two, he helps team on planning part two. In different ways he's actually helping. So there's a wide opportunity for the Scrum Master to actually add value. So let's come to the development part. Okay, so in the development part, okay, when it is during the sprint, you know, he basically makes sure that metrics means, you know, how many tasks got added during the sprint, or how many tasks got deleted, okay, or how many hours yesterday team have spent, okay, how much still the burn down, how the burn down is looking like. Okay, so like this, he can make sure that the information radiators are shown and team makes use of it during their stand-up meeting or design discussion or whatever interactions. And he can also trigger some ideas in terms of improving the productivity. I come across a situation wherein, when team wanted to, reuse the automation of the test suite, they were blocked saying that, you know, certain test automation framework is temporarily stopped. Then he said, why not we relook at the other test automation framework we have at hand? He just comes up with different questions to just make sure that people are actually thinking about, can I do it quicker, better, and cheaper? So Scrum Master actually comes up with good questioning, make sure that people think about it, connects different experts, and make sure that people think of, you know, getting things, you know, cheaper, better, and quicker. And he also can help improving the productivity through quick resolution of impediments. This is very, very important, my dear friends. See, we see scenarios wherein Scrum Master says, you know what, our teams are not participating in the events properly, like this. But, you know, there is action item on Scrum Master also. Whenever there are impediments, how fast he is able to get those impediments solved. You know, there can be n number of excuses, but we want the root of solution. So his Scrum Master is responding to team's enthusiasm with quicker resolution of impediments. Can within his capacity, is he able to make impediments that are not resolved for a long time to the highest level in the organization? So that's what matters. So in terms of solving impediments faster, in terms of making team think so that they can think better ways of improving their productivity, Scrum Master can leverage his development skills, his testing skills, his business domain skills, and he can actually connect to the team. And next part is XP practices. Friends, using Scrum, we can go to a certain extent, but beyond it, to get technical excellence or productivity improvement, it's XP practices that actually helps team to accomplish that mission. So he can actually come up with a plan saying that, my dear friends, today, these are the available XP practices for us. Now, can you please tell me what we are already doing? Okay, simple design we are doing, test automation we are doing. Okay, now let's ensure that for us to understand the XP practices like refactoring or the test-driven design or the continuous integration or the customer tests like this. So these are the practices we have at hand. Can you please come up with a plan saying that, you know, which practices will start implementing by what time and what kind of support you need, so that he can actually start conditioning teams. He can start enabling teams with required support, so that teams today, they implement with 4 or 5 XP practices. But maybe after 2 months or 3 months, they start including more and more number of test practices, XP practices into their bucket. So that's what he can actually make teams think in terms of that. And then he makes sure that during the discussions, okay, during the interactions, people are actually keeping the data in front of them. For example, burn down, burn up, task included, task down. On a given task, let's assume on a given activity, if 40 hours are there, only 10 hours work is completed, 30 hours more work is left. So he tries to bring as much numerical figures as possible so that people actually keep the reality in front of them and discuss instead of just talking out of intuition. So my dear friends, in development team, making sure the information mediators are available, making sure the team thinks in terms of improving productivity, making sure the teams have a roadmap of implementing XP practices and become mature team, Scrum Master has a say and he can actually work. The real attitude from Scrum Master is to consider himself as a servant leader. He should see a vision of self-organizing teams. He should see that long living and happy teams. So that being as a vision, once the intent is clear, then the direction will come automatically. So this is how he can actually help in development phase. Let's talk about collaboration. Okay, around 5 days back, one of my friends from the US called me and said, Krishnamurti, in UAT phase, okay, the customer comes and says, look, these are not the features I have asked for. I have asked for these features. These features have to be incorporated. By hook or crook, the team have to do. So that's the scenario I am in. So what's the way out, he asked me. So I don't want to get into further into the details of the context. But the important thing is the real end customer is involved. That's the R. Okay, that's very important. For whether it is a product planning, portfolio planning, or product planning, release planning, sprint planning. So to the extent possible, wherever, at least the strategy, product, the portfolio, product, and release, we want the real customers who are actually going to approve, who is going to provide acceptance. Those customers need to be available for us. And small teams are ensured, because the more larger teams we have much of communication channels happening. I'm sure there's a concept called N into N minus 1 by 2. So as more number of people comes, N becomes more, and communication channels becomes more, and it will be difficult to ensure best productivity out of it. And he basically makes sure that every conflict he manages properly, so that more trust is getting created. Friends, conflicts are very, very common on the ground. So a leader, a manager, a scrum master, if they resolve the conflict amicably and effectively, you see a better productivity there and innovation. So he basically can contribute to that. And cross collaboration index. Certain times teams think they are doing the best and they're actually collaborating. But if Scrum Masters together across the teams establish a framework saying that we get a feedback of 360 degree feedback on our team and make it available in index point of view or qualitative point of view, and it makes teams to think, okay, what others are thinking about us. So coming up with a framework where 360 degree feedback is made available to the team periodically, maybe in 1 and 3 months, so that people can start thinking and adapting to that, to those thoughts, because it's all inside out and outside in, they don't match. But to the best of our ability, we try to match these two aspects. So this is how he can actually use his interpersonal skills and make sure that collaboration is maintained. Now, during testing, acceptance tests are written. That means they are written in the suggested template. For example, given this scenario, when this happens, we want this kind of result. So that is one way of writing the acceptance test. So at the end of the day, every acceptance test should be measurable, and we should know what are the inputs, we should know what's the boundary conditions, and those acceptance tests should be measurable, and the user should be able to provide sign off. So acceptance tests, whether teams are writing properly or not, and you know, second thing is the test driven development means we basically wanted to develop the first test first and then code next. So that basically makes sure that every element of piece of code that we are entering into the system is fully tested. Because if you see today, there's at least 40 to 50% of the code that's not tested, still there in the production, and it's becoming a static code for us, and it's creating a lot of maintenance costs for us. Similarly, even though to the best of the team's ability, teams write the acceptance tests, you know, they come up with the test-driven design method, all those things, but still we encourage teams ad hoc testing. That means there is one concept where we have implemented on the ground saying that, you know, guys, today is a testing day. Anybody can test the system. Whoever identifies more number of bugs, they can actually achieve an award. So it's ad hoc testing. People try to test in their own way, and they identify some hole, and they can actually come up with the bugs. So we want such kind of bugs to be known to us before we actually deliver this particular code to the production. Similarly, non-functional testing, whether proper stress testing is happening or not, whether performance optimization is happening or not, whether additional hardware is required or not, whether teams, we need to bring different component teams at one shot to make sure that, you know, they think in 360 degree view about requirements about stress, performance, reliability, kind of a, or scaling options kind of a thing, whether people are actually considering those objectives in integrated way and they plan right from beginning or not. The Scrum Master has a role in this particular process. So friends, if you see here what we have done, we basically first leg is ineffective Scrum events. For that particular leg called ineffective Scrum events, we have seen how Scrum Master is actually helping in three steps: preparation, and then offline online coaching, and then third thing is during the event handling. So preparation is something first, okay, whether the reminders about the event is properly happening or not, whether people are notified about the events properly or not, that is number one. Next thing is what kind of obstacles we can see during the event, what are the options we have to mitigate it. Third, what is the agenda for each of the event, and what is the expected deliverables out of it? So can I take teams also into consideration while finalizing the agenda at the beginning of the meeting? And then so the teams are focused on the agenda rather than just talking, and at the end of the day, at the end of the event, they're just going thinking that nothing is solved. So typically, ineffective Scrum events, how in this particular case, Scrum Master could able to add value, we have understood. Similarly, issues with planning. That can be user story workshop, or product planning, or release planning, or sprint planning, or daily planning. In all aspects, Scrum Master can leverage his skills. He may have his expertise from development and testing. He can leverage that skills, and he can help teams to come up with a better planning outcomes. Similarly, the development also, we have seen how Scrum Master can help teams in making sure that team actually comes up with productive outcome at the end of development phase. Similarly, we have talked about testing. We talked about collaboration. And together, if all happens, that's what is action-based Scrum. So this is how, in this context, a Scrum Master would be able to do. So if you see here, I'm just going back. If in terms of Scrum events, you can see n number of ways. You can see probably 4, 3, 7, 10. So approximately 12 ways. Similarly, in planning, another 12 ways, 14. In development, another, at least 4 times. So 24 plus 4, 28. Here again, 32. Here again, 4, 36. So typically, approximately, we can actually come up and say, these are the 40 different ways a Scrum Master can actually add value to the team's outcome. What is important, my dear friends, is a human-touched Scrum Mastering. That's what is important. It's a role like, how a mother or a father plays in a family. They don't take anything. They want the children's best outcome. They want family best outcome. They don't want to work. This is my role. I want to play to this edge only. They don't set boundaries to themselves. They go beyond and help teens. And they help their children. The parents basically, certain times they take out of box decisions to make sure that their children are actually going towards the right way. Similarly, with a human touch, meaning you have to have the hat of a coach, and you have to understand every problem as an opportunity to bring creativity. Okay, and you have to connect the dots. You need to understand where we are, what are our strengths, where we need to be, and what are the possible alternatives we have at hand, how teams can contribute to it, any out-of-box idea we can bring, so how best we can do. It's all about problem solving. So my dear friends, the effective Scrum mastering with human touch can actually turn odds towards positive outcomes. But then, one statement that I wanted to say, the commitment from management is very, very important. Whenever Scrum Master is actually going back to the management and say courageously, this is what is not happening, that should be appreciated. Most of the times on the ground we see the effective Scrum Mastering is not happening, not because of the inefficiency of the Scrum Master, but because the environment, especially that is coming out of the management commitment, is not proper. So management, if they are subscribing to Agile, they have to understand each role, and they have to appreciate each role, and they have to look that each role is adding. They need to appreciate the Scrum values being implemented. So if management is not, the topmost management is not properly supporting it, then whatever we are talking, that basically gets into a different turn. That's why most of the times, in my opinion, top-down transformation is very, very critical for Agile. Because most of us all talk about bottom-up transformation, but it has to be supplemented with top-down transformation also. That's why a human touch Scrum Mastering and a management support who actually understand Agile and who are ready to come with the teams, and they're ready to experiment with the team so that Agile provides the value to them, is very, very important. So I'm open for questions at this point in time, Seema.
Yes, I have received good number of questions, and I have sent one question to you. Have you received?
Okay. Yes, I have seen question.
Yeah.
Yeah. Parthik Chatrala is saying, in most of organizations, teams are implementing Agile in a way that suits them, mixing and matching different Agile methodologies. So can we compare that to action-based Scrum, as in to do just what they want and what they suits them? No. See, Pratik, point I want to convey here is adherence to Scrum, what Jeff Sutherland or Ken Schwaber told, that is important. See, the beauty of Scrum methodology is it is giving a framework. It is not telling what to do within the framework. For example, if you take sprint planning session, what is the maximum time box? Who should be participating? What should be the tentative agenda? That's what they are giving. But how should they talk about stories? How should they analyze stories? They're actually not telling. Pratik, what I'm saying is, if every organization is implementing the way they suit, that suits to them. For example, some organization comes and says, I don't want Scrum Master. Product owner and development team is sufficient for me. I'm seeing value. No, I don't agree with that. Because with lot of thought, this particular framework is being put into practice. What is important when I'm saying action-based Scrum is within that framework, within the time box, within those roles playing, are we getting proper value or not? Can we implement new approaches or not? For example, I want to say one thing. There is one person who came for, there is a situation wherein teams are, they're taking more time to understand the story. Then the Scrum Master came back and said, look, why can't a core technical subject matter expert have some discussion with the product owner while grooming, and then bring it to the team, so that these people actually represent, these are the subject matter experts, they represent the team's opinion to the product owner, so that by the time the story comes to the team during sprint planning or product backlog refinement session, so most of the team thoughts are already incorporated. Thereby, we can improve productivity. So when I'm talking about action-based Scrum, it's about doing things differently within the framework set. So my dear friend, the thought, the framework that has been suggested as Scrum is actually, it is a solution in waterfall model, whatever we are experiencing. So to take it to the next level, in waterfall model, making sure that people are meeting and talking about a subject, it's very difficult. People, I come across situations wherein people say, I'm busy, my calendar is busy, there's a conflict. So making people together itself becomes a bigger problem in product organizations today. But Agile is actually by design making them together. So today, when I'm saying action-based Scrum, I don't want it to break the boundaries. I'm saying within the framework suggested by the Scrum, what are the different ways, creative ways, we can achieve productivity so that we can actually connect the value dots. So that's the solution I'm proposing, Pratik. So next question I have is, can sprint planning be part of sprint? Okay, so there's another question. Can sprint planning be part of sprint or should be away from a sprint? So it should be part of sprint. Every sprint starts with sprint planning, part one, part two, and then every day we have a daily stand-up meeting. And then mid of the sprint, we actually recommend to have product backlog refinement session. Review, sprint review happens at the last day of the sprint and retrospective. So this entire cycle should be happening within the sprint. Next question. Venkatesh is asking another question. When we choose a research story, how do we estimate it? Sometimes maintain, yes. See, research story are spikes, Venkatesh. We don't know how much time it takes. And then that's why we are calling a spike or spike. I mean, a spike means it just, when you say team comes and says, I'm taking a 20 hours of spike to see, to dirty my hands on it. So at the end of 20 hours, they come up, they may come up with a solution or they may just come up with an experience. So just hours they take. Similarly, on the research stories, they wanted to first experiment. They just take some hours. Okay? They say during the sprint, I want to come up with I want to spend 60 hours on it to research on it. That's it. So not more than 60 hours they do research. Maybe if the research gets completed in 30 hours, that's a different story. So if you're asking, how do we estimate it? We can't estimate, but we take some time. Okay, out of my team capacity, this much amount of time I'm reserving my research story. So at the end of the research story, of these many hours, okay, I may aspire to come up with alternative options of how to get things done. So that's how we discuss, that's how we present during the sprint review. So based on the research story outcomes, we actually take to the next level. Okay, next question. Murali B is asking, what is the Scrum Master role in product backlog grooming? Who are involved in product backlog grooming? A good question. Murali, Scrum Master role in product backlog grooming is, number one, all the parties are present there or not. That means product owner, development team are present or not. Number two, are all parties are properly, no, that means we don't want some people talking more and some people dominating, some people are not allowed to talk, we don't want that kind of composition. Third, whether stories are properly written and product owner has written proper groundwork or not. Next, whether acceptance criteria is properly drafted, means product owner comes back with one or two acceptance criteria. With the help of team, he basically derives further acceptance criteria based on the discussions happening. Next, whether the story estimation is properly happening or not. So, and next thing is the discussions are aiming or getting connected towards the story objectives or not. And similarly, the assumptions properly documented or not. Similarly, the upstream and downstream dependencies are properly understood or not. Similarly, if some wireframes are required from the product perspective, whether there has been noted properly or not. So it's just like, you know, it's just like he, even though as an organizer, he takes complete control, complete accountability of whether things are happening or not. He's a servant leader. Wherever something is not properly happening towards objective, he gets into picture and he helps. Okay. I'm just going to next question. In my organization, this question from Stefan. In my organization, I work at a company that is very prescriptive Scrum. Our leadership team does not understand value of Scrum or dev teams, and our dev teams are not doing any sort of XP practices. What is the best way to help become transformation agent for Scrum to help get our business where it needs to be? Stephen, it's another webinar topic for us. So wonderful question, but you know what? This is what most of the teams on the ground are experiencing. So friends, what I'm trying to understand is, you know what? We can't build Rome overnight, okay? So if you ask, the solution is we need a better expert. Maybe you can bring best coaches, who can connect to the management, who can connect to the business, who can actually come up with a roadmap. So clearly what I'm saying is, number one is the top-down transformation, bottom-up transformation. Also coming up with making sure that, you know, the organization also gets ready for agile transformation. For example, it's just not, you know, sprint, release, and these events. It's also about coming up with a flat structure. It's also about coming up with how the management structure is going to change after this. So from HR perspective, what should be the planning should be done? From the logistics perspective, what should be the planning done? So in my opinion, a coach support is needed to address the situation. We can't just answer over the period of time, but top-down transformation, bottom-up transformation, and the thought that, you know, it takes good amount of time. It won't just happen over a period of time. It takes some time. That time we have to mentor the teams. That's where we can actually get the transformation. So to answer this, it's the question everybody is facing, Stephen. We require good coaches. We require a agile transformation roadmap. Why are we taking this transformation? What business goals we want to achieve? So those kind of clarity we require. So I think we are getting in the time. So let me take last question. I would like to know the typical industry where Agile Scrum is applied. Is it suitable for hardware-oriented industry? See, friends, Agile Scrum or Agile is implemented wherever complexity is there, wherever clarity about the scope is not established, that is where you can use it. What we require is we want Scrum the way, the intended way we have to implement. It's not what you think about it. It's basically, Scrum is actually prescribing you certain gates. Within the gates, it is allowing you to be creative. So you can be creative within those gates. But those gates, for example, we want an iterative way of development. We want the customer to be involved. We want the planning to happen periodically. So those things have to adhere to. So if you ask me, it can be applied anywhere where complexity of a solution is there, where scope gets changed periodically or scope evolves. So this is where it can be applicable. I've seen, hardware industries are also getting into Scrum. So my dear friend, I want to talk about it. Next 2 to 3 years, the digital transformation is going to take us to a different stage. If somebody comes after 4 or 5 years saying that, no, I'm working on a project of 6 months, we probably consider it as a long-term project, okay? We will be seeing days wherein an app getting developed in 5 days, 3 days, 4 days, so maybe within 10 days or 15 days. So that's it. Within the time frame, we will be working. So the digital transformation is going to change the shape. If you want to do a litmus test, you think about 5 years. Do you think that 5 years back, this kind of technology we would be using now, did we thought about it? No. Similarly, this digital transformation, the internet, the way the consumers, they are going to change the way we are going to, the entire paradigm of operation is going to get changed. So that's why I personally feel that, you know, agile transformation is important step for every industry, because otherwise they can't release periodically. So I think we're crossing time. Rest of the questions, I can actually take it and I can actually answer. But before I conclude, I wanted to talk about a few things, and then before I leave. So I just wanted to say, discuss Agile, as Seema said at the beginning, they are doing their best possible effort to spread the knowledge about Agile, to make sure that best discussion happens, to make sure that industry-wide problems are discussed, to make sure that Agile is kept relevant to the ground. So as part of this, on November 21st and 20th at Hyderabad, similarly on November 22nd at Pune, they are doing, and they do a lot of meetups also. So I suggest you be part of it, because it's just interactions, making sure that those interactions are happening towards industry-specific problems that actually leads a better innovations, and those actually come up with a better solutions. So that's why we just want to notify to you that Discuss Agile is organizing these conferences in November. So you please see whether you can able to make up to these events and contribute to those knowledge discussions. I am also one of the speaker in Discuss Agile Day on November 21st in Hyderabad. And about me, finally, see, I basically started an initiative called Learn Together. Let's learn together. So every month I contribute to this kind of knowledge webinars. So this time, thanks to Discuss Agile for giving me the platform to share my knowledge to the wider audience. So these are my details. You can always get in touch with me. So with this, I want to thank your interest to learn, and I want to thank your time.
Yes, thanks Krishnamurty for such a wonderful presentation. I have received a lot of feedbacks about your webinar that they are delighted, they are happy to have you in this session. And I also thanks to all the participants for joining in, and we look forward for your further attendance in our various web events. Thank you.